what you got to say.
It's Hollywood Hernandez Live. How you doing? And here on set with me is world famous model, Miss Christy Ann. Before we get into all your other ventures and all the things that you've done and gonna do, we gotta talk about you being the official model on my book cover.
Oh my God, I'm so excited about that part.
Ain't that something?
That is something. I'm so honored. I'm so privileged. I thank you so much for allowing me to be on the cover of your book.
That's probably the biggest thing you've done, isn't it?
The biggest thing I have ever done. I'm going to tell you a true story.
Okay.
I was out on the scene about maybe a month ago, and some random person comes up to me, and they're like, hey, you're Christy Ann. And I was like, yeah. They were like, congratulations for being on the cover of Michael Hernandez's book. Like, true story. I'm not playing. That happened.
Wow.
So I was like, oh,
there?
Yeah, thanks. Oh my God, that's so cool.
Well, yeah. The book's out in a couple of months, so.
I can't.
And you got your advanced copy.
I got my advanced copy.
Yeah.
Now, I'm going to say this. I started skimming through it, but I haven't read it. But I'm super excited to read it. What I did read was really great. So I know once I dig in there, I'm going to be hooked and I'm not going to put it down.
All right. Well, yeah. That's enough about me. Let's talk about you.
Are you sure you don't want to talk about you anymore? I really love talking about
we
you.
We could talk about
you. We can talk about you.
We can talk about me some more.
You know I'm all modest and stuff. I don't like talking about me that much. But I'm here.
Okay. How did you get your modeling start? I know you were like 20 years ago.
Yeah, it was about 20 years ago. I had a good friend, and she was with this agency, and she was showing me her portfolio, and I was like, oh my God, this is so cool. I really like it. And she was like, okay, well, let me introduce you to my agent. So she introduced me to her agent, Sebastian Fashion Model Management. I still talk to him all the time. I'll still do projects with him here or there. Like, I totally love him. He's a really great guy. But he gave me my start in the industry, and we did a lot of fashion shows. We did some commercials. It was just a whole production that he puts on when he does his shows. So he exposed me to a lot and a lot of people, and it just took off from there.
And now you're in magazines.
Yeah.
You're always doing some exotic shoot someplace. Where have you been recently? Where'd you go?
Well, this past weekend, I was in Florida, but prior to that, the weekend before, I was in Jamaica, and it was a really good time.
Yeah, I bet.
I love Jamaica. Jamaica is one of my favorite places.
I do, too. Where in Jamaica were you?
I went to Negril.
I like Negril.
Yes, Negril is really cool. Jamaica is just like a whole feel, like a whole island vibe.
Yeah, exactly.
And I love it because, like, what you hear the most is no worries. Like, anytime something happens, like, that's what someone's reply will be, no worries. And that's just like the whole vibe of Jamaica.
And you know, the other thing is, whenever somebody, sometimes people stop you and ask you for money and stuff.
Yeah.
And if you just say, respect, man, respect.
Yes.
They back up.
Yes, because they're really aggressive over there.
Yeah.
Like, okay, off camera, Michael's told me a lot of funny stories about traveling. I love his stories. I live for his stories. Those are the funniest things.
Well,
he told me a few adventures that he had in Jamaica. It was hilarious.
All right. That's enough. This is gonna get cut short. I see that right now. Tell me about this movie that you're involved in that you did.
Texas Kill City.
What's it called?
Texas Kill City.
Texas Kill City.
Yes, Mario.
Not a romance, is it?
It's not a romance. But the little romance that happened, they ended up. It ended tragically, but
that's how they all go.
That's how it was. Yeah, it's Romario Fossi. He's the producer, the director of it. Really great guy. I admire everything that he does. But yeah, it's It's like a gangster movie. Oh. Some mobsters and some...
And I heard you even did some stuff behind the camera.
I did, and that was my first time. He trusted me behind the camera. That was my first time working behind the camera. So I started out, he's a good friend of mine. So he called me up and he's like, hey, I need some extras, come through. So I was like, okay, cool, I'll come through. And I was an extra here, there, everywhere. And then I guess something went along with production and he's like, okay, well, I'm short with sound. And you know what? I just need you to come through and assistant produce, direct this with me. And I'm like,
wow.
Right. I'm like, I really feel like that's a little too much pressure for me. And I really don't feel like I can commit. But he talked me into it and I did. And I'm so happy that I did because it was a really great experience. And I can't wait to see the movie when it comes out.
I can't either.
I know, I'm going to tell you.
There's got to be a big premiere, right?
It is, and right, as soon as I find
there.
Dates.
We're there, I'm there.
We are there, you're my date.
All
what
right.
What are you talking all about?
Right. Y'all heard it.
It's
y'all
on
heard
camera.
It, right?
It's here.
Wind that back and
rewind
and play it again.
Back. You know what? I'm going to say it again. No, it's totally going to happen.
Okay, all
I'm
right.
I'm excited about it, too.
I'm excited, too.
So, yeah, as soon as I find out dates, I'm okay. going to drop them. And you all have right. to, whatever you have going on, you have to clear it.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
You heard that.
All right. Okay. I'm there.
It's happening.
I'm so there.
Yeah.
You don't get killed in a movie, do you?
I do not.
Okay.
Oh, wait. I can't tell. Yeah, I can't tell you that. Stay tuned.
So you're doing so many things. What else you got going on? The modeling stuff and kind of like some entrepreneur stuff you got going too. Were you?
Yeah.
You just handling your business?
Do I? I can't even keep up with myself. What else am I doing? That is so cool. No, I have a nonprofit organization. It's called Tina's Place, and we serve a lot of the disadvantaged. Like, we had some group homes. I did shut them down, but I'm looking to start up some more group homes. But we do a lot of community projects, and yeah, it's a lot of stuff in the works.
That's great.
Yes.
For real, that is fantastic.
I have to come out with you
yeah.
one day when you do the
yeah, when we feed the hungry.
I totally have to. I know COVID kind of put a little
niche
in that, but it's fine. We'll
all right,
on
all
it.
Right. Well, we got a date for the movie.
We have a date.
And
I have witnesses.
That's it. That's it. This whole interview was worthwhile.
Yes,
right?
I love it.
It's good.
It's good. It's a wrap. We're done.
All right. We've got more guests coming up. So, hey, thank you
thank
so
you.
Much.
I love you all the time.
I know you drove yes. all the way from Denton.
And I'm on my lunch break, so I hope none of my coworkers are watching.
Uh-oh.
Don't y'all be snitching. Snitching get stitches.
Don't lose your job, okay?
Yeah, it's fine. They love me. It's cool.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. All right, y'all. This is Christiane, world famous top model, and my real good friend.
I love him.
And we're going to come back with more. So keep it right here. Don't go no place. More coming up on Hollywood Hernandez Live.
Bye, guys.
Welcome back to Hollywood Hernandez Live and my special guest, Mr. Robert Goody.
What's up, y'all?
Who everybody, they just know him as Goody.
Yes.
You know, Goody, we've had some guests over the last few months, and all of them said, you got to get Goody on the show. I had LaConda Davies.
Oh, wow.
I had Yarborough and Peoples.
Oh, yeah.
And they both just said, you don't have Goody on the show? I said, well, yeah, I'm going to reach out to him and try to get him on the show, you know.
Yeah.
But, man, they rave about you.
Oh, they're my people, man. You know, we was in the trenches together. LaConda, she first time she went out on the road, I was playing with a group, and she went out as a singer. And then she broke out, what she's doing. Of course, you know the story of Yarbrough and people.
Yeah.
We've been friends. Me and Kay have been friends since he was 12.
Wow.
taking him around the music.
That's know. A long time, because I know how old Kevin is.
And I'm 72.
No, you're not. Really? Man, you're looking good, man.
I'm trying to take care of myself, man, you know.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, still do my music.
So take us back to the day, man. How'd you get a start in this whole thing? Who discovered you?
I wonder if you remember a singer, he died a few months ago, DJ Rogers.
Yeah, Say You Love Me.
Say You Love Me.
Yeah.
He came to Dallas, and he had the place across the street, and I went down, and I'd heard about him, and I was dating a girl that was singing with Leon Russell, and out there down in Tulsa, you know, so we got together, and he told me, well, come on out, you can play on my first album, man. That was in 1977. I shot out there and stayed with him, sung and played keyboards on 2-3 albums, and he introduced me to the next step of it. And while I was getting put on, I knew Kevin and Lois was down here cooking something. They just needed to show them how to get that to that dough.
Uh-huh.
And told him to come on up, and Kevin drove up here, and the rest is history with that, man, you know. Kevin produced my, you know that picture I sent you of me?
Yeah, Kevin? Yeah, I got it. We're gonna show it.
That's my second album me and Kevin were producing. It was going good. And I started with the Gap organization. And, you know, I played organ for Natalie.
Uh-huh.
For 2 years, God rest her soul.
Natalie Cole?
Yes.
Oh, man.
Annie Mae, I called her.
She was incredible. I love Natalie Cole.
Her piano player's father died and couldn't make the tour. So the organ player moved to the piano, and he called me and said, man, if you can get this stuff down in a week, you can go. And man, I worked with her 2 years, went to Europe. So beautiful.
Wow. Mm-hmm. Man, yeah, she was incredible. Incredibly beautiful, too. She was a stunning woman.
About 4 years before she died, she came to Dallas to Ricky Rutch's church.
Mm-hmm.
And my mom called me and said, man, you better go out there. Your Auntie May is out there. And so I rushed up down to this church, and I was telling her, I said, man, could you tell her, Mr. Goodis, you know her? And he went back and said, and he came back and said, she said, send him back. And she hugged me, man, and thanked me, because I used to kind of look out for her on the road, you know. That was my first time I'd been on a gig, make $1,000 a week. She said, can I trust you to just help me? I said, yes. Never made money like that on the road. And we became good friends, man. She called me up about 6 months later. You want to go to Europe? Get your passport.
Wow.
She was really nice, man.
So you were with the label Total Experience, right? Which mm-hmm. was Lonnie Simmons?
Mm-hmm.
And did you work with all the different artists on that label?
Yeah. I was a co-writer on Oops Upside the Head with Charlie. And of course, I got a couple of things with Kevin and Lois.
Uh-huh.
And we had Penny Ford. We had a bunch of artists that, you know, that everybody would contribute to try to get a song in, you know. Of course, we didn't know anything about the business then, but I wouldn't take nothing for it. Because the things that I missed then, due to DPR, digital performance rights.
Right.
All the stuff I did back then, anything I played, produced, wrote, sung, they look at me every 90 days. That's how I've been able to make. God knew I didn't need it then. He said, no, wait till you get 72 and then you start getting you some checks.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, it's been good. It's been good, dog.
Wasn't there an unsung about you?
Well, it was.
You were in it, right?
It was Yarbrough and Peoples.
Okay.
And I was in that with them. He said, I can't do it without him, because this brought me out there, you know.
Uh-huh.
You know, it was saying that I was the guy to introduce him to the band, and he was so nervous at that time, he write his words down in his hand, because I had a pretty popular group in Dallas during that time, and then next thing I know, because he could sing, and the ladies liked him, so I had to have him in the band.
Uh-huh.
Didn't know nothing about Lois until I came through here with Natalie Cole, Six Flags, and came and said, man, I got a group Grand Theft going out there, place across the street, man. And I heard Lois hit up Ferris Snow, and I said, oh God.
Yeah.
Angel. And that's my sister from another mister.
Now, you were also on Soul Train. At least I didn't find any footage of you on Soul Train, but I did find footage of one of your songs. I think it was Do Something.
Uh-huh.
And they were doing a Soul Train line to it. You ever, I mean, what's that like to be at home Saturday morning watching the TV and you see them dancing to your song?
Let me tell you something, Mike. I recorded, did that show. And then, you know, you do it on a Saturday, everybody tape, and then you go and you don't know when it's going to show it. And back then, you know, it wasn't like now where you can pop it in, you had to get the VCR and wait on what number show you were and get them to send it to you. And I didn't see it for 10, 15 years, man.
Huh.
Yeah, and somebody sent me a VCR of it. It was so crazy because, you know, on Soul Train back then, they only had would have two artists.
Uh-huh.
And so it was totally experience day. So of course they got the Gap Man, they got Yarbrough and Peoples. So something told me to just pack my little suit up and get my, and just go.
And be ready.
And be ready just
that,
in case.
That little Candyman striped suit you had.
Popsicle Man.
Man, you look like, do you remember?
Mr. Peppermint.
Mr. Peppermint.
we did Reunion Rena.
Uh-huh.
And you know how you be partying 3 and 4 in the morning and 6, 5, 6. Look up, somebody said, "Dad Goody." And I was so embarrassed. That's the image they saw from me. I wanted to be like the Gap with the leather and the whips and stuff, but they wanted me to be Mr. Goody.
Oh, Goody, I got you.
Goody the Popsicle Man, melt in your mouth and in your hands.
So that's what got you wearing the peppermint suit.
And I told Doug, I said, look, Doug, I said, man, you know, my records just came out, man. I said, you know, Kevin and them got them hits. I'm the third on the label. I said, so I'm trying to, if I don't do Soul Train, ain't nobody down in Duncanville going to know that I'm
right.
A star or nothing like that. He said, man, would you? Now, that's how I understand, Doug. I started walking. He said, good. He called me back. He said, you know what, I figured it out. You know the Scrabble board?
Yeah.
He said, I'm going to cut that out. That's 2 minutes. He said, you get out there and do your thing.
Wow.
I don't know why you can get the footage. It's on YouTube. Me singing it, you know.
Yeah, you get everything on YouTube.
Yeah, I never forgot him for that, man.
So you got your 2 minutes performing on Soul Train?
And they liked the show till they...
I got to find that.
They they got a... They made that song of mine for the Soul Train line.
Mm-hmm.
They used it, and they used to play it every week. They were doing it for a while. And
yeah, well, you know, I mean, that's the dance. I want to do something. You know, tonight I feel like.
I'm telling you, man, it was like I was doing something that I needed to do.
Mm-hmm.
You know, of course, I'd been on there with the Gap. You know. We're caving now, but for me to do it, that was my dream. And we left and went on tour again.
I understand you're still out there producing people and working with mm-hmm. some of today's artists.
Mm-hmm. Yes. We got I have a studio where I can record. It's this guy named Gohard Black. He's E-40's first cousin, and I've been producing him. I did an album on him years ago, and we're doing some more stuff. Got songs on Don Diego. Yeah, that's what I do. That's I can't do nothing else at 72. I try to get a job. They said, going to hire you at 72. Yeah, it's been great. And I'm always catching you and carrying him. I said, man, I got to catch up with Mike.
Yeah, man, I'm glad we did. We hadn't seen each other since the 80s.
I know it.
But boy, we used to wear that song out on K104.
Oh, man.
Do Something. Give me a little bit of it and give the words.
Tonight, I feel like I wanna do something, cause I can't sit still. No, I got to do something.
Yeah, so if y'all don't know, now y'all know. That's Do Something.
Can I tell you a secret?
Yeah.
About that song. Do 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 do. Gotta get up early in the morning. Do,
do. Oh, that's the same.
Same. That's why people will accept it. They would say, man, it sounds like the Guff. But I did mine before they did, you know.
Uh-huh.
But it was all good, man, you know. All good. Because they took me out on tour with them. Charlie did. And everything, everywhere they went, I went. And every door they went in, he made sure I was. God, I love him, Charlie Wilson. Old Rockneck.
So, man, it sounds like musically, it's just been an incredible journey for you.
Man, 50 years I've been in the business.
Wow.
Because my grandfather was a sax player with Andy Kirk and Count Basie, and always with saxophones passed down in the family and a piano there, so I just took to it. His brother was a sax player, I had bands, and I just took to it, and that's all I just stayed at it. I made sure I met everybody I needed. You couldn't name nobody from George Duke to Patti LaBelle that I got to be around, and I would always take my notes from those guys, man. And George, matter of fact, Charlie was supposed to do the Soul Train thing, they're doing a new one, and we was hanging around, he was going to do it at our studio, but Charlie was late, and none of us said, man, you can do it.
Uh-huh.
I went in there and did it. And got a lot of gigs, more sessions from that, man. It was just a hustle out there. I stayed out there 20 years, man. It's just time for me to go home.
Man, you were on the road for 20 years.
I was in Los Angeles.
What's that like, man? Living on the road.
Happiness is your next hotel.
City to city.
Happiness is your next hotel room.
I like that.
It was back then, you know, we were younger.
Uh-huh.
I don't know. Hats off to Charlie doing 200-300 dates.
Really? He does.
He works, man. He's always been a worker.
He does.
I tell you, his brothers.
Robert. Yeah.
We had the same initial. He was Robert Lynn Wilson, and I was Robert Lewis Richfield, and we was the two Robos. Them boys. See, I met them before they were famous.
Uh-huh.
You know, when they was down there in touch with Leon, Leon let me come down there and do a session with my band, and they came in and we hooked up. And about a year later, I saw him in Hollywood. I said, man, let's go get it. And we started chasing them deals, you know.
Man, that's a cool life.
Yeah, that's I can't say that I missed the money. You know, looks like they trying to crank it back up where people are going out doing things. I'm glad to see Caven and Lois, and they doing something here pretty soon.
Uh-huh.
They're going to Vegas this morning and doing some stuff. I love to see them get out and work.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Wow. So are you personally, you got any gigs coming up, any place you're playing?
I just do recording, man. Sometimes it ain't worse unless it's gonna be something, you know.
Uh-huh.
Loading up your stuff and going, it ain't like that no more, man. I get a call, go do a gig here, Houston, somewhere, somebody. But I ain't really kind of into just getting in a band and playing just to do a gig. I just, God has fixed it to where my royalties and my old age and Social Security and all that, where I can live. You
that's
know,
all right, man.
Can eat.
Ain't nothing wrong with that.
And I play at a church every Sunday.
Uh-huh.
The last 4 or 5 years. So I'm just blessed to
so be. That's what's up with Goody.
And that's what's
playing
up
with in church on Sunday.
Every Sunday.
What church you at?
The Church of Nineveh at Ann Arbor and Marcellus.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Might sneak out there one Sunday.
Yes, man, we love it.
You're going to get me to church.
Yeah. You get to the church on time. Man, I really like your spot, man.
Yeah, well, yeah.
You invited me in, man.
Yeah, you need to come on back anytime, man. Anytime. I want to thank you for stopping by, Goody.
Oh, man. My pleasure. I thought I gonna miss it because I kept going up and down Duncanville.
Oh, really?
I saw 1423. I said, it's got to be it.
Yeah, we over here in the corner.
Yeah.
We're a little kind
of. I came in here once. I said, no, that.
You know, I gotta start telling people it's right next to the Texaco station.
If you say that, I would got it.
And right across the street from the water tower. That's my landmarks. Yeah. I got that next time.
Yeah.
I'm gonna get it. That's my bad.
Sounds good, man. Just the time you want me, just give me a holler, man.
Thank you for coming, man. I really enjoyed it.
Love you.
All right, buddy.
Y'all be good out there.
All right. Well, that's it. We got some more coming up here on the Hollywood Show, so don't go anyplace. You're watching Hollywood Hernandez Live. Hernandez live, and our next guest here in the studio, Mr. DJ Steve Nice. What's up, man?
How you doing, sir? What's going on?
Well, it's good to see you.
You know what? It feels good doing this right now, because see, this is a legend, you know, talking to me now. I grew up listening to him, so this is great. This is wonderful. This guy was on, he was on my book covers. So he's on my book when I was at elementary. I'm telling you, when I was at elementary school, he was on my book covers. The K-104 book covers, he was on the front.
All right, man. Let's talk about Mr. DJ Steve Nice. If you have ever been to the Essence Music Festival, you've seen DJ Steve Nice.
From 2011 to 2016, yep.
Are they going to do Essence anymore? Is it coming
back?
Oh,
yeah. They're going to do it as soon as COVID leaves.
That's not this year, though.
I don't think it's going to happen this year. But I know they definitely plan on 2022. I mean, they got a lot more to worry about in New Orleans right now.
So. Yeah, for sure.
But yeah, they're definitely going to do it.
Between the COVID and the hurricane.
Between the COVID and the hurricanes, it does not make sense to be in Southern Louisiana right now.
Shut down Essence.
Exactly.
But man, let me tell you, I went to Essence every year to cover it for ABC.
That's right.
And I'd be up there. That's my friend. That's my partner. That's my boy. Hey.
Big shout out to nephew Tommy from the Steve Harvey Morning Show, who is my frat brother. He brought me on the DJ form on stage. So that was six great years of fun.
Yeah, basically the two of you guys were the host.
Yeah.
Between every act, mm-hmm. you guys were out there on stage entertaining. Yep. He was telling jokes, you were playing music.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
It made the time pass a lot faster.
Yeah, because you know what? And my first year, I didn't realize how much time was going on in between the acts. You know, I always thought that because if you ever see it on TV or you see it from another entity, you're like, okay, they bring the acts on, they're right behind you. Then you realize that this is a long day and it's a long time in between these acts, and they got to get the different sets done and different stages done, and sometimes you got to find people, and it's crazy.
So when you're there backstage, do you bump into the artists? Do you see them?
Yeah, actually, yeah. You bump into all the artists.
So I'm curious, man. You were there the night that Prince tore mm-hmm. it down.
Mm-hmm.
Did you
get? We did not get to meet him.
Didn't get to meet Prince.
No one got to meet him. Everything was purple. And he had about 20 feet around him, and he would just walk, and the circle would just follow
really?
Him, and he just did not. He was very cool, but he just also didn't want to be bothered. But when some of his friends was on stage, he would jump on stage and play. Like Janelle Monae was on stage, and we was like, okay, this is a nice little act, and she was doing her thing, and he just comes out the back and just starts playing.
Really?
And everybody's like, Oh God, that's him. So yeah, it was crazy, man. But yeah, it was funny. Like him, Beyonce.
Yeah, now I know Beyonce's your homegirl from Houston.
She's my homegirl.
Mm-hmm. So did you know her back with Destiny's Child?
I knew her. I've been on her since she was 12 years old.
Really?
Mm-hmm. I was when their first album, as the group Destiny's Child. I knew them when they were on Elektra Records, but when it was the group Destiny's Child.
In Columbia.
Yeah. So I went to, her father invited me to the house to listen to the album.
Mm.
And he was like, I was like, it was me and a friend of mine at the station down in Houston. He said, look, don't trip, but the girls are going to trip out because we was there like at about 2:30. They were getting home from school at about 3:30.
Uh-huh.
So he was like, yeah, just chill out till the girls get here, you know. He's like, and they came like, oh my God, you like the album? I'm like, hey, you gonna be all right. I'm like, you gonna do something. You're gonna be all right. So yeah, I know I've been on it for years.
What kind of food they serve?
They didn't serve anything.
No food?
Nah, we were just drinking water, matter of fact. Matthew, you owe me dinner. I just figured that out. Yeah, 15, 20 years later, you owe me dinner. Yeah, that's right. Yeah, I didn't get dinner that day, so no.
You know why I mentioned that? You know our friend Jay Johnson that we worked at ABC with? He told me a story once where he went to Barry White's house, him and his wife. They invited him to his house.
Nice.
And check this out. What they had for dinner?
What?
Kentucky Fried Chicken. They had boxes and boxes of Kentucky Fried Chicken.
You know what? I can see that. If I'm not mistaken, Barry White's from Galveston.
Yeah, he is.
That's why. That's it right there. That's the Galveston. Yep. Great stuff, though, man. Mm-hmm.
Who are some more people that you bumped in backstage? I want to hear more celebrities stories.
You know what? It's because it was such backstage where they have this celebrity area with bars and seats and things. So you would just bump into everybody. Usher. I mean, people who weren't even performing, they would just be back there hanging out. It was amazing. Media people than anything.
Yeah, I had heard a story from one of my friends that was a reporter. What's her name? She was on like not Entertainment Tonight, one of those shows. She said that that year, I don't know if you remember that year, but Chris Brown and Rihanna were both on the show.
I wasn't there that yet.
And she said that Rihanna.
That had to be 2009.
Yeah, she said that Rihanna was like giving Chris a hard time because this reporter was really cute, and it's like, you know, you're gonna talk to her and all that. And she had to tell off Rihanna. Said, look, I don't want your man. Okay, I'm here to do a job.
I have this theory that Rihanna's slightly jealous. She has no reason to be. But the things I've heard about her, because she has a couple of instances like that, I think that she's slightly jealous.
Huh.
Rihanna, you have nothing to worry about. Call me. I'll give you all the attention you need. I promise. No, one of my monumental moments backstage. We was eating dinner. I ate with No Addition, and I think because I don't think about that as much because I'm a fan.
Right.
So we're sitting at a table. It's me and all six of them. And they just eating. We just having fun. They just talking. And I'm like this.
It hit you, huh?
It hit me. I'm like, I am sitting at a table eating with New Edition, Ralph, Ryan, all of them. I was like, oh, I'm just looking. And because I'm in my work mode, so I'm not paying attention. Then I had to look up like, oh, my God. And it's just us. Just shooting stuff at the table. Trip. I didn't take a picture. I'm really bad with pictures. I'm sorry about that. And that's when posting was. It was still recent. Posting was cool. I didn't have my camera out.
Oh man,
I'm terrible.
You are terrible. I'm all about the pictures.
See,
you know? You
take great pictures. You take the best pictures with friends and everything. I'm like this. I'm just gonna eat. phone right here. I'm just like, I'm thinking like, I should take a picture. Then I'm like, I don't want to bother him and be the fan that I am, cause I'm still a fan.
Yeah.
And fortunately, I'm still a fan. So, yeah, man.
Yeah, you know, just over the years, cause like I said, man, we've probably known each other like close to 20 years.
Mm-hmm.
We have both come across so many artists. And,
yes.
And you know, sometimes it's just overwhelming. Sometimes they're just so friendly that you don't even think about who they are, you know.
Oh, you know what? I have a small story. The first person I ever met was in 1992, was Mary J. Blige.
Huh.
And it was in Houston. And I was really, I just got to the station. So I didn't even know how to actually came out, sat down. And I'm this little skinny kid from Texas Southern. How you doing? Nice. And she's like, I'm like, okay. You need anything? It was a first introduction to the business.
Mm-hmm.
So, I got kind of the Mary J. Blige with an attitude, but I didn't pay attention because I'm new to everything anyway. One of my coworkers got upset, but. Come back tenfold. 10 years later, I wound up interviewing her on the station, and she was just as gracious and just as warm and loving and forthcoming. And I realized that between that point and that point, this was 1992 to 2001, that she had been through so much, and she had a lot to reflect on. She had nothing to talk about in 92. She was brand new, little ghetto girl, just talented, and that's it.
Mm-hmm.
But by the time she came back 2001, she had to talk about her relationships and, you know, the slight drug problems and everything she was talking about. She was very, and I was like, wow. And I didn't want to tell her. I'm a kid that she was here in 1992. you just treated right, like trash.
Blew me off.
But she was wonderful.
Mm.
Yeah, man. But you know what? As a matter of fact, you have come across so many artists. And you came along at a time when radio was radio.
Right, right. It was important.
It was theater of the mind. We all ran to it to listen to it. And that's why I always brag about the book cover, because I didn't know what none of y'all looked like. So when the book cover came out, I'm like, oh, wow, this is them. I'm a kid. So I'm like, okay. So now when I listen to the radio, I'm like, oh, that's him. Oh, that's him. Okay, it was great, man. Radio was such that was, you guys are the reason that I got into radio, because listening to you guys and how professional you guys were and you with the stars and Tom Joyner is at the American Music Awards.
Yeah,
sitting next to Lionel Richie and Gladys Knight, and at that time that was his crush. He was crushing on Janet.
Yeah,
Gladys
yeah.
Knight every day, and that just made me want to be a part of. For one, K104, but mainly just the radio professional, because that's what you guys really steered that. You know, listening to Dr. Rock on weekends, and we would just listen to it. It was actually just as big as TV was, if not bigger, because it was hit. TV wasn't hit. It was not taking away from anything. It was Miami Vice hit.
Right.
It was cool, but it wasn't hip and in the culture like you guys were. That's what got me into it.
Well, thanks, man.
Oh, man, look. I got tons of stories to listen to y'all.
Well, let me ask you about some of your history.
Okay.
You worked on BET, MTV,
mm-hmm.
right? What were those shows that you were doing?
And actually, this comes from college. I got to make some guest appearances on BET and MTV through a college friend of mine. They had his name is Dr. Teeth. He's a music director now, but at the time he was working for BET. So every time he needed a host, he would like call me to come up and either come up and host by myself or to be a host with other people. Like I worked with Rachel, Big Tigger, and all of them for like 2 years. And had a lot of fun, but the thing was, coming from school, he and some buddies, from some acting buddies and some guys from the band, had a group called Why Not Us, Why Not Now. And so we were all coming up together. I just started on the radio in 92, and they just started their group. So they were trying to raise some money. So they would come to me and be like, well, could you DJ our function? We don't have a lot of money, but we're trying to raise them. I said, no, I know you guys. I'll help you guys out. And so I helped them guys out. So when they got huge, when he got big, he brought me on. And that's a lesson. When you're coming up, you help each other out.
Exactly.
Nobody's a star at the time. So you help each other out and you come up together.
Speaking of your college days, I read someplace where you played college football.
Yeah, I played with Michael Strahan. Yeah, I played with Michael Strahan.
Really?
Yes.
Michael Strahan.
Mm-hmm.
And what position did you play?
I was a place kicker. And this is a funny story.
You were a place kicker?
Yes. Now here's where my sports history comes from.
Uh-huh.
I was a place kicker here at Carter,
uh-huh.
Dallas Carter. I'm on the same team with we won state. So the movies that you
Carter
see.
Carter High,
yeah, that's us. I was on that team. I got a scholarship to Arkansas Pine Bluff.
Cut. We got some three.
All right, Steve, look, forget all that, man. Can we talk about you?
Right.
I heard that you were a college football player.
Yes.
On scholarship even, so you must have been kind of good.
I was. I'm not one that took my own horn, but I do that with that particular situation. Yes. Got a scholarship. I played for Carter here.
Uh-huh.
In the 80s, I was part of the Carter State Championship football team in 88. I got a scholarship to Arkansas Pine Bluff, 89 and 90. Played there for 2 years. And I transferred to Texas Southern, and I played ball with Michael Strahan, who you guys see on TV right
yeah,
now.
Yeah, yeah, mm-hmm. Cool.
Yeah. So we had a lot of fun. It was, and I did my pro tryouts with the Saints and the Raiders.
At what position?
Place kicker.
Place kicker.
Yep. Yeah, look.
I wish you'd have made it, man, because they don't have no black kickers in the NFL.
Financially, I wish I'd have made it, too. So, yeah. But you know what? Honestly, back then, especially in 91, 92, that was the Deion era. So I'm at my tryouts with my gloves on,
mm-hmm.
wristbands, towels, and I'm kicking.
To be a kicker.
And the scout's like, son, okay, well, the receiver's over there. I'm like, I'm a kicker. They're like, son, we don't have time to play this. We need you over here with the receiver. So, I am a kicker. I had to go kick. I had to show them that I kicked. As I was at the combine. I had to show them that I kicked. They're like, oh, you are a kicker. I'm like, yes. But I was. Oh, it was fun. The football days were fun. It was great. Like I said, coming from Carter, going to Pine Bluff, going to Texas Southern, it was wonderful. Man. It was a wonderful experience.
Now people know you now on K104.
Yeah,
you do mixes there all the time, and you're on the air there all the time. But you're on like every syndicated show and local station. How many stations are you on?
A combination between the D.L. Hughley Show, which I work for every market but here, and my own syndicated show. It's about 100 stations.
How did they pull you off the D.L. Hughley Show locally?
Well, because I submit my mixes in, you know, I can't be on here.
Right, so they have somebody else for this city.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. I'd be dang. I never thought about
so
that.
But I DJ for him nationwide. And when I got laid off in 2008 from K104 for financial reasons, and I came, I'm not coming back in 2009, but in that particular time, I was like, you know what? I could start my own syndicated radio show.
Yeah, you're New York, right?
It was actually started with Oklahoma City and Shreveport.
Uh-huh.
And it just spread to Little Rock, and about now I got 15 stations, which is really good for me. And then while I was doing that, you called and asked me to come to your format.
Uh-huh.
So I did that, So I always stayed busy. It was great. Well, I mean, good. Working with you was great.
All right, man. Well, thank you. Yeah. I'm humbled.
This guy here with a desk is crazy.
We had a lot of fun. All right, y'all. That's going to do it. Thanks a lot, man.
Yes, sir.
Appreciate it for coming by. DJ Steve Nice.
Hi, Mom.
In the house.
I made it. I'm on TV. See?
Hey, that's going to do it for the show this week. I want to thank everybody for coming on the show. Had a real good time. Remember, until next time, do a random act of kindness for somebody. It just might change the world.
Yes.
Peace.